This must be my bag. I thought I had the camera playing. I'm the background music playing my bag. But shalom, 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 shalom. Once again, you're under the sounds of the voice of Kahan Tazadaq, and this is your Habushwar. For the record, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel. And please be advised. All the information I'm about to give you, strictly for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. It's not to be taken as legal advice. First and foremost, giving all praises to Abanawa, the Supreme Abraham of our forefathers, of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, whose proper name is Yahuwah. All praises due to Yahuwah, Yahusha. So, once again, I'm here to invite you to the up-and-coming webinar this weekend, which is actually going to take place this Saturday and Sunday. You are invited to Redemption of Your Sister K Trust, Control of Your Straw Man webinar. When? It's going to be May the 8th from 12 noon to 6 p.m. and May the 9th from 12 noon to 6 p.m. You could click the link below this video, or you could click the link in the room and pre-register. It is going to be advised that you have my book, Commercial Warfare. We'll actually be going through that book. We will be going through the book, Commercial Warfare, breaking down a lot of those terms in there. Many people get the books, they don't read them. So it's going to help you out a little bit. So that's going to take place May the 8th from 12 noon to 6 p.m. and May the 9th from 12 noon to 6 p.m. I'll post the registration link in the room once again. And again, you want to have Kahan Tazadaq's book, Commercial Warfare. Commercial Warfare, it's this book right here. Don't get the books and don't read them, man. I mean, come on, family. If you get the books, read the books. This book by hand, we're about halfway through it. Very valuable information. And this book has actually saved a lot of people's lives. So you want to read these books at least five times as a minimum. What's going on, Torres Bay, on the plantation? What's going on, Mr. Evans? So, by the way, let me just run through my books real quick. This book right here was the first book that I wrote. It's The Infliction of Commerce. Now, what you can find in this book, basically, in this book, the aphorism, contract equals law and law equals contract. In this book, it covers how Rome colonized America with commerce. Then it takes on a revolution of your mind, which is complete constructive change, try to break you down and reconstruct you from a more positive perspective. Thumbs up as you come in the room. Then your remedy comes from within. I talk about that. I even speak about comprehending, overstanding legalese. In this book, it also teaches one what to do if a clerk refuses one's documents. How to stand in a colorable court effectively. Thumbs up as you come in. How Kahan Tazadaq construct an affidavit of reservation of rights. A lot of remedy in this book. Small book, but a lot of remedy. But it's worth its weight in gold. Why government IDs have all capital letters. This book explains that. To those of you that's novice to this, you definitely want to get this book. It also explains why a man does everything under the heading of an affidavit. Then Kahan Tazadaq talks about the brainwashing of the masses. Talks about the gold French flag. Have you read this book yet, Danielle? Chanel Danielle, have you read this book yet? What about you, Mr. Evans? I know you have the book, Chanel Danielle, but have you read it? And clearly get the comprehension, you got to read it at least five times. The gold French flag talks about that in this book also. The new voluntary slaves. It talks about public policy. And it also very it expresses very well something that most of you painfully do not want to admit. Proverbs 22, verse 7. The borrower is the servant, and the lender is the master. It also talks about extricate your estate, secure party creditor. How one can rid oneself of property taxes. It teaches one how to separate the straw man from the living soul. In order to really be effective in law, you really need to know how to separate the straw man from the living soul. You really gotta discern between the living soul and the straw man. You always gotta create a distinction. Then it goes into specific case laws for father's right. Those of you that may be dealing with support issues, child custody issues. And people's rights versus citizens' rights. I'm not sure what's going on. I see the numbers going down. Thumbs up as you come in the room. See my signal's a little weak now. Got a little stronger. And notary certificate of service. It goes into that. So you definitely want to get this book. The Infliction of Commerce. You can visit the website, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org. Peace. Know your value. Say, when I use Zoom, I do not get good reception. It keeps on freezing. That is why I backed out of the last seminar. I do plan on purchasing. What was the last seminar that you attended, Noya? That's got to be something on your side. Your resources is actually not strong enough. You probably need more RAM in your computer, or your internet connection is just not strong enough. So, because it's better to really be in these live, because you can't ask the book questions. You know, the books are excellent. You can read them over and over again. But you can't ask the book questions. If the book starts talking back, run. The other book, next book, Commercial Warfare. This is the book that we're actually using right now for this particular up-and-coming webinar. The Truth About Identification Cards, Rights versus Privileges, Nature of the Law, Beware of Internet Fraud. All these people on here alleging to teach you something, but teach you just enough to get you in trouble. Request for an oath of office. This book teaches one how to complete a UCC-1 properly. When a county clerk refuses your documents, this book helps you what to do. There's many writs, affidavits, and so on and so forth in this book. How to claim nationality as a Hebrew Israelite is in this book. How to rescind and revoke unjust adhesion contracts. What could the authorized representative of Tazadaq be talking about? How to revoke unjust or adhesion contracts. Some contracts you're coerced into, like parole and so on and so forth. You don't have an option. Affidavit certificate of non-response. How to construct the notice of default. Answering a counterclaim. How to construct a fee schedule, right? An accepted for value method. Notice of fault, an opportunity to cure. Notice of default. What money really is. House Joint Resolution 192. An explanation why how the banking system works in this book. What to do before going into colorable courts. Perhaps some of you need to go to court. This book goes into what one should do. How to properly challenge jurisdiction. This is in this book. Many of you really need that. The issues of law are threefold, right? When you first go into a public venue referred to as a court, first thing that needs to be done for educational purpose is to establish the status. Then the next thing is not to jump to the merit of the case, whether or not you're guilty. The next thing should be challenging the jurisdiction of the court. Does the court have jurisdiction over the subject matter? Does it have personam jurisdiction? The court doesn't have jurisdiction. They only proceed because you allow it. Do you understand? Affidavit of Reservational Rights is in this book. An example, how to properly challenge jurisdiction, how to deal with foreclosure is in this book. Very powerful. Notice to arresting officers with a Miranda warning. How to authenticate your birth certificate is in this book. There's many positive affirmations that many of you need. What to do if the clerk court does not accept my paperwork. Again, how to change your name, legal notice, declaration. How to claim nationality, how to beat criminal charges in admiralty court. Legal phrases that every creditor should know, and much, much more. So that's the second book, and that's the book that we're actually going to be going through throughout the webinar this weekend. To those just coming in the room, thumbs up. And again, this video is about the up-and-coming webinar this weekend, how to redeem your Sister K trust. And so the next book is Red Pill Right Knowledge. I actually wrote this book when I was actually fighting for custody of my sons. This book is very informative, has a lot of maxims of law in it. It teaches one how to do a notification of administrative violations when you're violated, notice of conditional acceptance, how to defeat so-called debt collectors, how to really effectively deal with them and when. Let me say this. There's a difference between a debt collector and collections. Collection is usually a legitimate attempt to collect on a bad debt. And collections is usually employed by the company. Whereas a debt collector, it's some third party that's just coming after you that purchased your information online. It goes into various maxims of law, specific case law for child support, notice of removal to federal court, how fathers can get custody and receive child support, how to file a declaratory judgment, how to serve a summons on an individual, motion of default judgment, how to beat traffic tickets, how to do a motion hearing, how one could actually do a 1099 OID for all court cases, how to do a notice to arresting officers. Again, what is money? Affidavit of fact, writ of discovery, notice of special appearance, how to do a proof of service, notice of reservation of rights, demand for dismissal, revocation of power of attorney, taking your power of attorney back from the de facto state, and from 28 U.S.C. 3002, subsection 15A. Affidavit of specific negative averment. What is an averment? Look it up in Black Laws of Bouvier's. How to properly challenge jurisdiction in order to show cause and a motion to vacate is in this book. Very, very informative. Which brings us next to the corporation. This is revised. If you have the older version, this one is updated and much better. The corporation, that's an acronym that I came up with for crooked officials robbing people of rights against truth in our nation. Corporation. We the people versus the autonomous warrior mentality. Your blueprint for greatness and success. What's this in this book? Understanding contract law. Three things you should require from all banks that claim that you owe a loan. That right there alone sells the book. Well, four things required to make a contract valid. Can any of you on this call tell me the four things that's required to make a contract valid? You should know these type of things. What more would one value than the how to defend oneself properly in life by learning the common law? How Tazadaq discharged thousands of dollars in alleged credit card debts. How Tazadaq guided a friend to win against the IRS CRA in Canada. The 10 rules of commerce. How to purchase real estate with private credit. The TDA. Rights versus privileges. From public law to public policy. How states became corporate. Why There Is No Money, Remedy by UCC, Allocution, How to Live as an American National. See, all of this stuff is in this book. And what this is telling me is you people are not reading these books. You're buying them. Maybe you're reading at lunch. You're skimming through it. You're going to a section that you want to see. But you're not reading these books as you should. Otherwise, you would actually know this stuff. Let's learn, King. You would know this stuff. How to Get a Loved One Out of the Box for Entertainment Purposes Only. This right here is worth 5 G's or more alone. Affidavit of Reservation of Rights. 5 reasons why not to get married, not to get a marriage license. Overstanding adhesion contracts. Administrative remedies. Stand out of the public court. What is a true court of record? Conditional acceptance. Order to the secretary or clerk to perform specific duties. How to beat traffic tickets, once again, is also in this one. Affidavit of denial with travel and comments. Affidavit of mistake. Oh, you made a mistake. You signed a contract you didn't agree with. Affidavit of mistake. Thumbs up as you come in the room. Copy and carry, something that one should actually carry in their wallet until they memorize it. Affidavit of independence. Revocation of power of attorney. Notice to clerk. Removal of zip codes. Verify the true birth. What is nationality? Notice and demand to all law enforcement. Substantive rights. Allodial and feudal titles. Why nationality is important. Affidavit of religious exemption. Notice of special appearance, answer and counterclaim, notice and demand, what to do when charged with driving without a license, practical overstanding of the 1099 OID process, 1099 OID for court cases, affidavit to challenge jurisdiction, the due process clause, people's rights versus citizens, privileges, trial brief, quiet title for foreclosures, Social Security trap, rejection of contracts, acceptance of oaths of office, demand for probable cause, motion to support evidence of false arrest for lack of probable cause, proof that accepted for value works with Sallie Mae loans. Why you should become a secure party creditor is all in this book. Thumbs up as you come in the room. What's going on, Brother Bay? All of that's in this book. On to the plug. As you see, this is going to take some serious reading, my hand. This is a thick, really thick book. I think it's 572 pages. You got writs. You got affidavits. You got the brief. A lot of stuff in this book. Understand what I'm saying? It took a lot of time for me to put this together, man. It's worth its weight in gold. Now, what do we have in here? We have laws of the creator, the common law, which is the laws of nature, the straw man birth certificate bond and living soul, thoroughly explained, overcoming your altered ego and self-defeating thoughts, representing yourself in court, overcoming semantics and colorable courts, how to stand as a secure party creditor, right to travel from point A to point B without a driver's license. So we're in this book. Notice the court and all court officers. Affidavit of truth. Affidavits that the authorized representative of Tazadaq used to defeat foreclosure case. Answer to criminal complaint. Motion to vacate judgment. Foreclosure case. Again, the courts are colorable and only have consent over those that consent. 1099 OID for checking account. How to wipe your credit clean. Canada or US. A writ of mandamus. 1040V set off. Declaration of land patent. Affidavit of acknowledgement and acceptance of warranty deed. Conditional acceptance. How the authorized representative Tazadaq made a bill into a money order. Legal notice to bank. Conditional acceptance letter to discharge bill. What is due process of law? Mortgage and discharge letter. Notice of competency and incompetency. Revocation of power of attorney. Challenge jurisdiction properly. How to authorize representative of Kahan Tazadaq have discharged debts. District United States. And that, therefore, no United States federal statutes or regulations have any authority over me. Have I created a promissory note? Spiritual warfare and cognitive dissonance. How to have a baby in a hospital and not get a birth certificate, a social security number. Notice of understanding and claim a right. Claiming your nationality and status as an Israelite. Three stages of notice of commercial lien. Contract rejection, child support letter. And how to rescind a social security number and birth certificate. And much, much more. You see, this book is... there are 576 pages. The plug. You need to get the plug in order to unplug. Thumbs up as you come in. And again, the links in the room, essentially this video is about registering for the webinar this weekend. But I'm actually going over my books here. Because, you know, there's a lot of new people listening and they're not aware that I actually write books. And so, finally, the newest book, Liberate the Oppressed. As you can see, this is the thickest. It's like a dictionary. This book is 700 and some pages. What I actually been covering in these webinars is pretty much in this book. The webinars over the past 6 months or so, it's in this book. I mean, I didn't type up a list to tell you what's in here. I never got to that. But the webinars, the OID, the EFT, I believe that's in here. Accept it for value. So many different things are in here. You see, I'm talking about how the banks, it's official newspaper, banks here open for business after the shutdown, 1933. There's so many remedies in here, how to deal with debt collectors, one could actually repair their credit for educational purposes, get out of debt, get loved ones out of bondage. There's affidavits, there's writs, show you how to deal with foreclosure, child support. This book is loaded with information. If you could keep it, that right there is Liberate the Oppressed. Liberate the Oppressed. It's the name of that book. It's the newest and thickest. Now, what was that, Kenneth? How do I go about ordering new to this channel? Oh, you just go to the website. Let me post a link to the website here. Just visit the website, brother. Hold on. And then you go to the shop page. So it's truedisciplesofchrist.org/shop. And you could order that there. Now, primarily what I was actually doing this video in regards to is the straw man, right? This is what the webinar is actually going to be about this weekend. And it is recommended that you have this book if you attend the webinar, Commercial Warfare this weekend, right? The webinar is going to be about the redemption of your sister Q trust, your sister K trust. Taking control of your straw man webinar. It's going to take place May the 8th and 9th from 12 noon to 6 p.m. on both days. Click the registration link in the room and go ahead and pre-register now. Now, I know many of you have actually heard the straw man so-called theory. It's about redemption. But how are we redeemed? How do we ascertain this redemption? How's this redemption really ascertained? Book of Ephesians 1 and 7 says, in him, meaning Hamashiach Yahawashah, the one that you ignorantly call Jesus Christ, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. So our redemption comes through Hamashiach Yahawashah. It doesn't come through a man. Colossians 1 and 14 says, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sin. In Canada, the social security number is a sin. Social insurance number. It is a sin. But did you know previously in the United States, it also was referred to as a sin? Social insurance number. So we are redeemed through this right knowledge from our sins, if you could keep it. Book of Galatians 2 and 20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. You've been crucified with the noose of student loans. You've been crucified on a cross of credit card debts, auto loans, you name it. So you've literally been crucified with Hamashiach Yahawashah. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So you're supposed to become Christ-like. That means the Ruach HaKadosh is supposed to be moving in you. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of the Supreme Elohim, who loved me and gave himself for me. Book of Titus 2 and 14 said, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness. What are we under? Are we under the law? No, we're under lawlessness. We're under public policy. They tell you that it's law, but it's not law. It is exactly what they tell you it is. It is codes. It is rules. It is regulations. It is policies. It is not law. It's not operating under a de jure law. It's operating under a de facto system, existing in fact, but not legally established. Colossians 1 and 20, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in Shemayim, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you kadosh, holy and blameless and above reproach before him. What is this taking control of your sister K trust, your straw man? What is a straw man? And how does it make a difference? See, the straw man is defined in Black Lord's Dictionary 6th edition as a front. As a front. A third party who is put up in name only to take part in a transaction. A nominal party to a transaction. A nominal party to a transaction. It is a front. I don't want you to believe me. Matter of fact, I challenge anyone under the sounds of my voice to go and research everything I'm saying right here. I dare you. Thumbs up as you come in. In Barion's dictionary, in Barron's, should I say, third edition, the term is also used in a commercial and property context when a transfer is made to a party. The straw man simply for the purpose of retransferring to the transferor in order to accomplish some purpose not otherwise permitted. So they do these things to the straw man. You have to admit that you're the straw man. You got to create some sort of Joinder, Blackmore 7 edition defines person as an entity, such as a corporation created by law and given certain legal rights and duties of a human being. A being, a real or imaginary, who for the purpose of legal reasonings is treated more or less as a human being. Also termed a fictitious person, juristic person, legal person, moral person. See, the concept of the straw man was born in 1933 under Franklin Delano Roosevelt executive order to confiscate gold from the people. With executive order, and I don't want you to believe this. So I want you to go and write this down. I dare you to go and research everything that I'm saying. He done this on executive order 26102. That's executive order 26102. Go and check it out for yourself. Roosevelt made private ownership or hoarding of gold illegal. He made it illegal to have gold. And of course, his order only had jurisdiction with the federal zone of Washington, D.C., the Virgin Islands, Guam, Puerto Rico, and the American Samoa. So in other words, the federally controlled territories is what he had jurisdiction over. It didn't apply to us, we the people, but we didn't know that. Roosevelt created Social Security and furthered this country's march towards communism, towards communist control government. See, where one man is forced to pay towards another man's upkeep, especially the elite, you're forced to pay towards the richest upkeep. Under the planks, under the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto, all property would be held by the state, which is currently right in play right here in the United States Corporation today. You can't even call me a liar, man. They got that from the Communist Manifesto. And it's currently in play right here, and we know it to be true. All you got to do is look at your deed of trust. How many of you think you own a home? Go and look at the deed of trust. Look at the deed of trust and seeing we are being listed as tenants on the deed of trust. Tenants in common or joint tenancy. You're not listed as an owner. You're listed as a tenant, just like someone staying in an apartment. So if we're renting as tenants, see, tenants rent. Tenants don't own. So you're renting your home, but you don't understand the language that's being used because of aphasia. You've utterly lost the ability to comprehend words. They've done some damage to the mental faculty of your mind. But if we're renting as tenants, who is a true owner? Now, this is what a thinking man would ask. It is a state who can take your property without the due process of a court case required under the Fifth Amendment. How are they able to do this? Hold on. I thought they was operating under the Constitution. Think about what I'm saying, folks. The wool's being pulled over your eyes, man, and you don't even know what the hell's going on because you don't take the time to learn the law. Think about it. How can someone just come and foreclose on you? They have non-judicial states. They come and take your home, man. You're supposed to have due process of law according to the Fifth Amendment of the United States Constitution of the Republic. Every other plank is also in play right here in the United States Corporation under communism. Under House Joint Resolution, no one could pay their debts anymore. According to the United States Constitution, we will pay our debts with gold or silver. So because Congress denied the right to pay a debt from now on when they took the gold, we can't pay anything. I need you to really think about what I'm saying here, people. And since they took away the gold, there could be no requirements to pay any debt. And there could be only set off of debt.
Set off is where bookkeeping shows the balance to be zero, but the debt is not paid. See, the real issue is money and what money really is. What is money? Can anyone define money? Can anyone define what money is? Anyone in the room, can you define what money is? What about it, Laurel Jean? Can you find what money is? What about it? Anyone in the room, can you define what money is? What is money? Apparently, it is whatever we agree it is. It is a medium of exchange. See, in the past, it has been seashells, cow dung, wooden sticks, pieces of paper with ink on them, salt, cigarettes, and probably many other things. All of this is money. Oh, word the apostle. Well, what do you know? Word the apostle pops up again. Got a message for you, Ward. Hold on, Ward. Got a message for you. Ward the apostle pops up. Interesting. Ward the apostle.
Word the apostle stop being a little bitch.
You hear that, Word? We don't want that nonsense around here today, man. Word, man. We don't come over here talking crazy, man. We got good energy right here now, man. Hey, Word, man. You see that tourist bay? He popped back up, man. We don't want that Word, the apostle, around here, man. You brought some confusion the last time you came here, Word, the apostle.
Word, the apostle, stop being a little bitch.
Hear that, Ward? That's how we feel about you over here, man. You can come as a man. You don't come at all, man. We don't want that feminine energy back over here, y'all. Let me get back to the subject matter at hand, man. Had to snatch that, man. So nevertheless, man. In 1864, the National Banking Act was passed, and it stated that any bank could actually loan money based upon the deposits of a promise to pay. So any bank could loan money based upon a promise to pay or the deposit of a promissory note. So in 1913, the Federal Reserve Act allowed a private group of mostly foreign banks. You know who they were, man. Zionists. Foreign banks to issue elastics form of money that was called Federal Reserve notes. A Federal Reserve note is a promissory note or a promise to pay, but would only be payment if you went to the bank and demanded gold or silver in exchange for that note. The government borrowed enough money from the feds, who created it, out of thin air. When I say the feds, I mean the federal, which is not really federal at all, the Federal Reserve Bank, which is not really federal at all. They printed it out of thin air to go bankrupt in 1933, or just before its 20-year charter would run out. And after the Congress could actually not rescind the act. So the federal government now was a debtor in bankruptcy to a privately owned bank known as the Federal Reserve Bank, which is about as much federal as the Federal Express. You understand what I'm talking about? Banks who issued worthless paper with ink on it in exchange for gold. And then Roosevelt, who had to save the banks and reconstruct the country. So the people had found out that their money was worth $35 an ounce of gold in Europe, and that the Federal Reserve's value was $20 an ounce of gold. And we're actually making a run on the banks to get their gold out of the banks. The people wanted their gold out of the banks. So the value of the American dollar has risen, and the people wanted their money. The banks didn't have any gold to give. They didn't have any gold to give out, as they flooded the markets with worthless paper notes, and they shipped off countless tons of gold to Europe. They shipped out gold to Europe. So the Federal Reserve notes were a contract that stated they could actually be exchanged for gold. The banksters would have all gone to jail and maybe have been hung by the crowds, except Roosevelt stepped in with troops to stop the people and save the banks. Does that sound familiar? Sound familiar? See, under the addendum to the 1917 Trading with the Enemies Act, Roosevelt in 1933, he amends it to state, and I quote, "During time of war, during any other period of a national emergency declared by the president may, through any agency that he may designate or otherwise investigate, regulate, or prohibit under such rules and regulations as he may prescribe by means of license or otherwise, any transaction in foreign exchange transactions or credit between or payments by banking institution as defined by the president, and export, hoarding, melting, or earmarking of gold and silver coins or bullions or currency by any person within the United States or any place subject to the jurisdiction thereof." That's Title 1, Section 2, 48, Statute 1, March the 9th, 1933. I can't make it up. I can't make this stuff up, man. So now that Roosevelt created a banking holiday to save the banks, he had to ban the hoarding of gold and be able to borrow money to run the government. But from who? And with what collateral? What collateral would he use? This is noted in Black Law's fifth edition. Black Law's fifth edition, it states thus, Bank Holiday of 1933, Presidential Proclamation number 2039, issued March the 6th, 1933. Number 2040, issued March the 9th, 1933, temporarily suspended banking transactions by members banks of the Federal Reserve System. Normal banking functions were resumed on March the 13th, subject to certain restrictions. See, the first proclamation, it was held, had no authority in law until the passage on March the 9th, 1933, of a ratified act, 12 U.S.C. 95B. So the present law forbids members, banks of the Federal Reserve, to transact banking business except under the regulations of the Secretary of the Treasury during an emergency proclaimed by the president. That's 12 U.S.C. 95B. See, family, there's always been a national emergency as shown in the Senate report 93-549. Senate report 93-549 from 1973, suspending our Constitution. Since March the 9th, 1933, the United States has been in a state of declared national emergency. In fact, there are now many presidential proclaim states of national emergency. Trump did it, remember? But in addition to these national emergencies declared by the President Roosevelt in 1933, there are also the national emergencies proclaimed by President Truman on December 16, 1950, during the Korean conflict, and the states of national emergency declared by President Nixon on March 23, 1970, August 15, 1971. The list goes on and on and on. See, Roosevelt would institute Social Security, which is essentially a communist plan where one man supports another without his consent. See, the people will become human resources. This is why when you go for a just over broke, you go down to the human resources department because you are a human resource. So the people will become a human resource and the bankers would loan on the value of each man's labor throughout his life as a collateral. So the 14th Amendment in 1868 states each individual as a citizen of the United States, which is a voluntary position, cannot question the public debt. How convenient. How convenient. So each person can be a corporation, and a person will have a birth certificate printed on bond paper, and that will be a bond, and the person will become a vessel under maritime admiralty law. Strongman in all capital letters. The sister K trust, the liaison, the corporate construct. This will be the flesh and blood, natural man's woman, commercial trading company. Your straw man is your commercial trading company. Do you understand? That is your commercial trading company. Do you know how to use it? Commercial trading company. For what? For the public debt. You can't question the public debt. Each person became a corporation. See, whenever the flesh and blood man gets a bank account, right? Watch this. Whenever the flesh and blood man gets a bank account or a bill from a corporation, whenever he gets a driver's license or any license from the corporate state, it will be in the vessel's name in all capital letters. Why? 29 CFR 78.3.38. 29 CFR 783.38. Statutory definition of American vessel, section number 783.38. Name. Statutory definition of American vessel. The United States, as distinguished from a foreign vessel, includes under the terms of the definition in section 3P of the Act, any vessel which is documented or numbered under the law of the United States, the Department of Treasury, Bureau of Customs, and the United States Coast Guard, respectively, are responsible for documentations and numbering of vessels. So, what does that mean? 30-30? So, would a birth certificate be documentations and numbering under the laws of the corporate United States? So, if John Doe, all capital letters, is a misnomer or the wrong name, try and get them to give you a license or a deed of trust in your upper and lowercase name and see what happens. See, on the signature line, you sign your name, right? On your checking account. Look at your check with a high power magnifying glass. Get a high power magnifying glass and look at your checks. Where you sign that? It says authorized signature only. Over and over, authorized signature only. So why would you put micro print on a signature line on a negotiable instrument? This is what you need to figure out, folks. Why did they do that? Why did they put micro print on a signature line on a negotiable instrument, a legal document, if the words had no meaning? Think. The corporation is a fictitious entity. It has no hands, it has no eyes, it has no brain. It cannot affect any changes on any flesh and blood man. So they had to create something that could actually be affected on an equal footing, such as a corporation that represented you. Only a flesh and blood man can change you. Only a flesh and blood man could charge you in court for an injury or a breach of contract. A corporation cannot charge you, a flesh and blood man. I'm just an aggrieved man. But it can charge another fictitious entity. So the trick is that they ask the flesh and blood man to stand in surety for the corporation. And not knowing the difference, you do it. I would stand in place of the fictitious corporation in court when my name is called, rather than point out that isn't my name. It's similar to my name, but it is in all capital letters, and that makes all the difference, right? So to gain control of the Sister K trust of the straw man, one has to understand that the straw man is what his purpose is and the rules of law that allow one to get your needs met. Now let's go over what the Sister K trust of straw man is once again. The straw man, all capital letters, right, is a vessel in maritime admiralty law, a corporate fiction, in legis, meaning a creature of the law, a fictitious entity with no hands to sign a document, no mouth to object to any mistreatment, and as such, cannot act, cannot drive a car, cannot sign a bank card, nor loan application. And yet the driver motor vehicle license, the bank loans, the car loans, the marriage license, the contractor's license are all labeled with the all capital letters name as the responsible party of entrance. Why could it be? Because real flesh and blood man is in a sovereign status and doesn't need a driver's license if not engaged in commerce? Could it be he does not need permission to work on people's houses, which would be illegal without a license under the force of legislative powers, usurped by falsely operating democracy? And in fact, a common law right to contract and work in whatever one desires, stated in the Declaration of Independence as the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Could it be? What requirement could possibly exist to get a state-issued and controlled marriage license? Why make the state a party to controlling your relationship, which is actually only supposed to be between you, your spouse, and the Supreme Elohim, the Creator? Could it be that it gives the state the right to possess the fruit of your union of your children? Yes, this is how they could come in and take them. This is the straw man's function, to falsely represent you, the flesh and blood man, and give the corporate government the rights to control you through the straw man. See, the United States is a parent corporation with all other forms of government subservient and divisions of the parent. A corporation can have no effect lawfully on flesh and blood man and flesh and blood woman. Why? Because it is dead and fictional. So this is why they need to invent another dead fictional entity to be equal with, that everyone is deceived into standing in as a surety. The responsible party for the all capital letters name is testament to the failure of the community to tell each member the truth of what is going on in Alice in the Wonderland fairy tale. So what can one do about this? You attend the webinar. You learn right knowledge. You learn how to handle this. You get Tazadaq's books that were shown. Can the relationship be changed? See, we have to overstand the rules of engagement in this world. The maxims of law that are 100% true all the time can't be questioned except by tyrants and dictators who will make up arbitrary laws at their own whims. See, first and foremost, is failure to object means you agree. That's a maxim of law. The maxim is stated, an unrebutted affidavit stands as truth. This is why a creditor, a man, does everything under that heading of an affidavit. An affidavit is your sworn testimony. Blackstone tells you what an affidavit is. An affidavit is not an affidavit simply because you write an affidavit at the top. An affidavit has to have an oath attached. Look it up in Blackstone. See, you can only testify what is your experience and not someone else's experience. What you witness and not what someone else witness, as that would be hearsay. See, when in court, your sworn testimony, if it is not objected to, or countered stands, it stands as the truth. It's correct in the final word. This is very powerful information, folks. Case in point, right? Let me give you an example. An example would be that your credit card company falsely states that you signed for a $3,000 vacation rental in Hawaii. And you didn't even go to Hawaii. See, if you don't rebut that and object to it, what do you think will happen? You will be charged the $3,000 because you acquiesce. You have to object, folks. Even if you say, I don't think I did that, they will charge you. You don't have to tell a big story or even justify your reason. Just state that it is false and that's your sworn testimony. American vessel refers to any vessel documented number under the law of the United States. The Department of Treasury, the Bureau of Customs, and the United States Coast Guard respectively and responsibly for documentation numbers of vessel. 29 CFR 783.38. It also includes any vessel which is neither documented or numbered under the laws of the United States. See, they know, folks, that unless they got a sworn affidavit by someone else stating that you sign for vacation or rentals, they lose. See, the problem will come when they try and get someone to swear to it, because the hotel concierge will not want to put his name on the document swearing that it was you, because he does not know you, and he knows or has no reason to believe that you are consenting to it. Do you understand? No one would think lightly of swearing something is true unless that is their experience, because the commercial liability, or in other words, courtroom liability that comes of giving written evidence. Another maxim of law, truth is sovereign in commerce. And it is obvious if a contract, one party is lying or being deceitful, they lose in court. So if you declare something to be true, it had better be true. However, as you become liable, if it is not true, if I declare my straw man is a fictitious entity, do I have to worry that he will object to that? No. If I declare that the straw man owes me everything he has acquired in his bank account, his deed of trust for the real property, his title to the car, his furniture, etc., etc., he doesn't object. That makes it true, right? See where I'm going with this? Strawman's not going to say something and say, oh, I don't know the strawman stuff. Is strawman going to say anything? No, he can't talk. He's dead. Will he object? But no, will he object, Melikar? Strawman can't say a damn thing. Or more importantly, how could the strawman object? Was it not my labor and blood, sweat and tears that purchased those things? If I want everyone in the world to be able to know that I am the creditor and that my straw man is the debtor and owes everything in his possession to me, could I do that? Yes, I can. I simply just construct my UCC-1 and put it on my security agreement. Boom, it's done. Financial statement, financial lien. And that everyone could witness the straw man, John Henry Doe's indebtedness to me. John Henry Doe up in lowercase. See, what the difference would be is incredible. You should tell us about what difference would it make. Well, once you do your public recorded secure party creditor process and send it off to the respective entities that they recognize you as a creditor and not as the straw man, not as the debtor anymore, and give them 30 days to rebut your right to do that. 30 days. They see you differently after that. How many of you became secure party creditors? They pull you over and let you go. I can't make this up, man. Talk to some of the people that got pulled over, man. They let them go. Once they become creditors. They got 30 days to rebut your claim, Melikar, of being a creditor. Separating yourself from the storm man. Who is the defendant? John Doe, all capital letters. It is never the flesh and blood man because they can't charge a natural man. So the court wants John Doe, all capital letters, to pay a fine. Get in line because you have a superior claim. You claim everything John Doe owns, all capital letters, right? Understand what I'm talking about, Malcolm? And then some. How about claiming he owes you $100 billion in silver coins? Will he contest it? The UCC-1 is the evident, a lien, or a contractual relationship is in place. This is why they don't want you to do it. This is why they're blocking them in so many states. They know this. If it had no validity, they would not be trying to block it. So once Tazadaq Shah files a UCC-1, he's established a lien. He's established a lien over John Doe, all capital letters, or Tazadaq, all capital letters, which is a debt owed over that fictitious entity. And the court will have to get in line, as they will have, they will never be able to collect. They have to get in line after you, first in line, first in time. They can't collect anything without you getting paid first. You understand what I'm talking about? First in line, first in time. See, when the UCC-1 is filed, you file a property list that includes everything in the kitchen sink. I'm talking about your security agreement, and your property list. Real property, cars, boats, computers, files, your hair follicles, your DNA, your spit. You put everything on that thing. Paperwork. With your name on it. Get creative. Go for it. For educational purposes. Think it out. Think outside of the box. This list will be loaded up as an addendum and evidence of a debt owed to you. Once you finalize your filings to the secure party creditor process, you will have the whole thing recorded. You put these people on notice. You see what I'm talking about? So then when they try and bring something against you, they were actually not get paid until the lien is first satisfied. This is how you get someone in control of your straw man. Once you get in control of the straw man, now it's time to go out the birth certificate bond for educational purposes. What do? You accept it for value, for educational purposes. Go to the county where you was born for educational purposes. Get 3 copies. 3 certified copies of the birth certificate. County where you was born. They need to be certified copies, not just some damn photocopy. Otherwise, they're worthless. I take that thing and I accepted it for value. See, they figure most people use for the value of the birth certificate bond is millions of dollars, man. Once you accept that thing for value, what happens to it? Once one accepted for value, can they not write a bonded promissory note? I've seen many do it. A promissory note is just a promise to pay. Same thing as a Federal Reserve note, a promise to pay. But the truth is you will never get paid because the paper has no value. And the Federal Reserve banks don't give you anything of value. The store owner currently accepts them in good faith. So until the Federal Reserve note is exchanged for something of value, it is evidence of a debt. It is evidence of not being paid. Or in other words, it is a debt. So what is the difference between trying to pay the store with a seashell, with a pencil, a piece of Monopoly paper, and a Federal Reserve note? They both have no value. See where I'm going with this? The store owner refuses the seashell because he fears no one else will value them. But he thinks there's a difference with the Federal Reserve note. There's no difference. It's paper with dead white men on them. Green and white ink. So since the passage of House Joint Resolution 192, anyone could actually set off a debt, but not pay a debt. A proof of value is the order to set off a debt. Since you can't pay a debt, the entity giving you a bill, which isn't a bill, it's just a statement, has to give you the means to set off the debt, as you can't pay it with a debt instrument like a Federal Reserve note. So the means to pay is the coupon at the bottom of the statement for educational purposes. The coupon is a negotiable instrument. It has the necessary elements of a check which are date and time for set off, the amount to be set off in dollars, who is setting off the balance, or we think of it as being paid, and just needs to be signed by you with an order to pay to complete it as a check. Do you understand? It's for educational purposes only. Obviously, I'm not telling anyone to do this. So any public corporation has to follow these rules of the United States parent corporation, of which they can't demand to be paid in gold or silver. So they can only require set off or zero on the account. But this is not true with private debt between you and Tazadaq. Private debt is where one flesh and blood man contracts with another flesh and blood man on the private side. You cannot pay off Bob with an approved for value. We're on the private side. But when you got the loan for your car, since they created the money with your signature on a promissory note and didn't actually advance on any of their money, you could send them a payment coupon stating you are the authorizing the Treasury Department of the United States Corporation to use your exemption account at the Depository Trust Corporation where your birth certificate is housed and accounted for to set off the amount of debt due. Do you understand? See? There we live in Wonderland, where nothing is real. And of course, you have to now see Wall Street has obviously known about this for quite a while. This is why there's no limit to the greed and corruption. And they never give anything of value while they demand that you work for everything that you get value of. See, to see the Wizard of Oz for what it is, a description of the monumental changes the government was fostering on the unsuspecting public. The straw man is the fictitious entity created for the commercial control. The TIN, tin man, is the newly created tax identification number. The cowardly lion represented the Congress, who allowed the bankruptcy to happen without challenging the Federal Reserve because they didn't have the courage. The yellow brick road represents the gold disappearing into the Emerald City. You understand? City where the Federal Reserve green paper note replaced the gold. The Wicked Witch of the East, the Industrial Corporation, and the Wicked Witch of the West, the banksters, the wizard who didn't want anyone to know what was going on, is the Federal Reserve Banks. The evil woman who wanted to take everything, total, to take everything, mean all, where total means everything in Latin, represented the banksters taking the farms and the property of everyone during the Depression. See, originally, Frank Baum, the writer of The Wizard of Oz, wrote Dorothy having slippers as silver, but they later became ruby slippers. It represented them finally taking silver away from you. See, slave masters here in America, and this is one of the topics where the cognitive dissonance became easily apparent, as it is impossible to believe that this is really happening at a first glance, even with evidence supporting the explanation of these things. Only little by little will one be able to absorb this monumentum travesty forced upon the public by the evil banksters on Capitol Hill. Do you understand? So, I'm gonna again encourage you to go ahead and sign up for the webinar. Click on the link in the room. Webinar is going to take place this weekend, Saturday and Sunday, from 12 noon to 6 p.m. on both days. Webinar is going to take place. You go ahead and pre-register now. And it would be a good idea to have the book, The Corporation. I'm going to post the link in the room one more time. Can you believe that this guy showed up to the channel again? this guy that called himself the prophet. Word. The apostle. So with that, man, I believe. What's going on, Carefoot? Shalom. Let me post a link in the room, man. Anyone got anything to say, man? I'll let you say it right now, man, for a few minutes before I get up out of here. Most high willing. Niggas, Carefoot. What you got, man? Links in the room. Anyone that have anything, any kind of feedback, except for Word the Apostle. Word the Apostle, he created... fabricated stories. He flying up in the sky. He being taken up in the sky by Christ with Timberland doing. Ridiculous. What time is it over there, Carefoot? Anyone got anything? Real quick.
Yeah.
Word the Apostle, stop being a little bitch. Word the Apostle, stop being a little bitch. Word the Apostle, stop being a little bitch.
Yeah, you hear that, Word? You hear that, Word the Apostle? Get out of here with that nonsense, man. Look, Word the Apostle said great info. Yeah, Word the Apostle, but Ivy already told you what's up, man. You gotta stop behaving like that, man. Stop putting yourself out there, man, like a simp, man. So with that, man, I'm gonna bring this to an end. Since no one have any questions, I'm gonna say shalom, and I'll see you the weekend, most high willing. Al Bashem Yahweh Shabbat.